In the last episode, we have introduced the elliptic curve and showed how to implement a key exchange protocol using it. But we haven't covered how Alice and Bob would authenticate each other's identities. This can be done with a Schnorr signature. Let's see how it works.
The essence of the Schnorr signature is proof of knowledge of the private key. Let's say Alice has a private key X and a public key P. Bob knows Alice's public key. To make sure that he's in fact communicating with Alice, Bob will ask her for proof of knowledge of the corresponding private key. How could she provide such a proof?
The naive way would be for Alice to simply reveal her private key X to Bob. Bob would multiply point G by that number and compare the result with a point P. If it matches, then Alice indeed knows the private key.
But this does not work for Alice, because now Bob knows her private key and can make proofs on her behalf.
Okay, what if instead of sending X in the clear, she sends a blinded version of X? To do this, Alice creates an additional random number R, also called a nonce, and commits to it using another point, uppercase R, which is computed in the same way as the public key. Then Alice blinds X by adding R to it, modulo number of points on the curve. We will call the result a siglet. Finally, she sends Bob the siglet S and the nonce commitment R. Bob now knows S, but cannot learn the private key from it because it is blinded by the nonce. However, Bob can verify that S matches the sum of the public key P and the nonce commitment R. If Alice correctly computed S and R, that equality would hold.
Do you think at this point Bob will be convinced that Alice actually knows the private key? What if she had chosen an arbitrary number S and manipulated the commitment R so that the public key is subtracted from it? In this case, when Bob checks the equation, the verification will always succeed for any value of S, because the public key will be cancelled out.
So the only issue is that Alice can cancel out the public key by subtracting it from the nonce commitment. To protect against this, Bob could challenge Alice to guess the number of times she has to subtract the public key. We call this number a challenge, C. For this to work, Alice will have to choose the nonce and send the commitment R before learning the challenge. Since Bob chooses the challenge randomly from an astronomically wide range of numbers, Alice has effectively zero chance of guessing it correctly. This prevents her from subtracting the public key precisely that number of times.
Let's see how this works. If Alice knows a private key, she honestly commits to her nonce R, sends the commitment to Bob, and receives a random challenge. Then she multiplies her private key by the challenge, adds nonce, and sends the resulting siglet to Bob. Bob does the same computation with points P and R and compares the result with S by G. If this succeeds, Alice has successfully proven her knowledge of the private key.
Great! This protocol is now sound, but it is interactive, which means that both parties must be present to verify the proof. What is more useful is a non-interactive scheme where the prover creates a signature once and others can verify it any number of times without the prover's participation. Turns out there is a trick called Fiat-Shamir transform that allows us to use a cryptographic hash function to simulate this interaction. Instead of sending commitment R to Bob, Alice puts it into a hash function. The hash function returns a pseudo-random challenge C. The security promise of a good cryptographic hash is that it is infeasible to choose an input data for any desired output. So Alice won't be able to choose how many times to subtract a public key from R and then have a hash function return that exact number. The hash function will be customized for each message, so a signature on one message cannot be reused on another message. Now, Alice has a 64-byte signature consisting of the nonce commitment R and the siglet S. She sends it to Bob. When Bob receives the signature, he puts R and his message into a hash, computes the same challenge, and verifies the signature equation. If the equation holds, Alice's signature is valid.
Let's recap. We need a signature scheme that lets anyone authenticate messages. We start with an interactive protocol that proves the knowledge of a private key. To protect the private key, we blind it with a secret nonce. And to make sure the blinding portion does not cancel out the public key, we introduce an unpredictable challenge number. Then we make the scheme non-interactive using the Fiat-Shamir transform by generating a challenge through a cryptographic hash function. Finally, we make sure that the signature cannot be reused with a different message by binding the challenge to the message. The resulting scheme produces a 64-byte signature that can be verified by anyone with a corresponding public key. And this is the complete protocol for the Schnorr signature.